we don't hit it faster. And that's the simple principle. There's no rational, in my opinion, counter-argument to that better model. Understanding that it's one force, not four forces. They'll even talk about four forces in one context, and then, you know, they believe that the one force is somehow a bent geodesic, and the other force is some sort of virtual photon, which doesn't make any sense. I mean, these are obvious flaws, and, you know, this bizarre effort to keep saying this isn't just a religion, they're reciting out of a Bible. They've created characters in their religion, the Holy Ghost, these imaginary permutivity of space or some other bullshit character, and then they have to give them functions. And so, yes, when you take a million people and give them 100 years to play with a silly story, they'll come up with a very elaborate role for this little Holy Ghost to play. Oh, the Holy Ghost keeps Jesus from giving the store away, and, God controls the Holy Ghost, and so it ends up like some rock, scissor, paper bullshit. So they can make this stuff fit as some kind of narrative, but the narrative is fundamentally flawed, unevidenced, and purely imaginary, in the sense that it doesn't really have much correlation to any real facts.
They do, how they share energy and so forth. So, after a few more videos, doing this one here, hopefully they have a better idea of what a photon is. So
yeah, you'll demonstrate it with very little evidence and argument made, and there certainly won't be any requirement for there to be consistency. Particle wave duality, it's a non-starter.
Some basic things about photons. First of all, a photon is a piece of energy, or a chunk of energy. The energy that's been exchanged between any object in the universe and any other object in the universe is done so by sharing photons, by sending photons from one to another.
So there, I mean, it's a perfectly agreeable statement that is rational physics. I mean, it's rational to understand that it's the force carrier is basically just saying, I'm momentum. Okay, if I'm going this way, I'm going to hit something, I'll move it that way. And if I'm going this way and I hit something, I'll move it that way. Okay, and the real subtlety is, how does it move it? I mean, does it hit something and it stop? No, we kind of know it doesn't do that. So it must sort of jump into whatever it's going to move. And then the question becomes, well, doesn't the thing it jumps into gain mass or change if that's what it was doing? And so maybe you have this idea that it jumps in and some piece of the thing jumps out. And so it always stays the same. Electrons are all the same, whether they're moving or not moving. They only have so much stuff in them, so many rowers in their boat, and that's all there is. So I'm just saying, you can simply diagram this, okay? I'm not disputing any of the math fundamentally. I'm saying, yes, okay, E equals HF will work if all you're after is, did it produce electricity? But if you're after more than that, okay, that's underdone. That's understated. That's not saying enough about the fact that volume is real. So if I have the infrared light on for an hour and I have the ultraviolet light on for 4 seconds, I'm clearly going to produce more energy from the infrared hitting the surface. There's going to be reactions that will be real, both in terms of reflections and absorptions of heat. And it's just nonsense to say, no, the ultraviolet automatically wins the race. No, of course it doesn't. Volume matters, and volume is all you're really talking about in the end, is how much of the volume went from one place to another, how much real momentum, and then the only question is, how much of the momentum was transmitted into real action? And that's it. It wasn't wasted as heat or converted into something else. So you can go back to sound or anything else. I mean, if you're creating the sonic boom, how much of the energy is actually wasted in the sense that it doesn't get released as movement of atoms in a coherent manner, it gets released in some incoherent pressure on surfaces.
Getting down just a moment. So it's really a piece or a chunk of energy. Secondly,
he says this thing. and then they'll just throw it out the window and start doing this crap. You know, it's a movement, it's a perturbation in a field. It's a, you know, it's the permutivity of space. It's some other kind of horseshit. Some other kind of garbage.
We can say that a photon has no mass and it moves at the speed of light.
So again, this idea that it can't have a mass, they'll change that to their discretion. So if when they need it to have a mass, they'll pretend that it gains mass from its momentum. So momentum is automatically a mass gainer, but it has no rest mass. That is, if you kept it not moving, it wouldn't have a mass. But to clearly give it a mass in the equations, something less than zero, so it doesn't mathematically come out to zero, because they know it has real momentum. So they give it an arbitrary, infinitely small mass, merely to say its velocity is its mass, because in most circumstances, like in gravity, for example, velocity is all that matters, not your mass, in terms of how the gravity will affect you.
So whatever it is, there's no mass, you can put them on a scale, well, actually you can, because they can only exist if they move at the speed of light. So you can't stop them and put them on the scale and weigh them, but they still...
Yeah, so all you're doing is weighing their velocity, because, and frankly, that's all you're doing when you're measuring the weight of a human being or anything that has mass. You're measuring photons, essentially, as reflections, as how much of the universe are they able to reflect back at you and create pressure, and that's all you're doing. So when an electron is opposing another electron, it's opposing it because there are actually these little force carriers bouncing back and forth, and the closer they get, the more that pressure builds up, and that's the pressure that makes surfaces surfaces. That's what makes atoms have any integrity, is the very fact that it has that stuff trapped between them.
Don't have mass, so no mass, they move at the speed of light.
So again, a statement that's just totally unnecessary, right? There's absolutely no reason to say it has no mass, because mathematically you'll give it mass. So why are you saying one thing and then doing exactly the opposite? Because you know that you can't say it's bent by gravity unless you give it some sort of fake mass. You have to give it mass or it fails in the mathematical equation. The mathematical equation will say there's no bending because there's no mass. So why play this game that you're saying it has no mass? It clearly has momentum, it has no mass. You know, when it's going this way, it has no mass going this way or going that way, and it certainly has no mass going the opposite way, so in some dimensions it has no mass. You can't push on it, because you can't move anything fast enough to push it, so you can't feel any mass. But does it mean it doesn't have momentum, and that's the real thing that mass is made out of, is how much pressure can you produce? That's what you're measuring.
A photon acts like a particle. It turns out a photon can hit another particle, like an electron or a proton or something, and actually bump it like a billiard ball.
Right, so it's not like a billiard ball would be the argument. Clearly the billiard ball transfers its momentum and the billiard ball stops. So if I hit another ball, or a cue ball, the cue ball stops, the other ball takes all of the velocity and goes in some new direction. Photons aren't doing that. So that's wrong. So you have to have some other description of the pure kinetics. The pure kinetics have to be something like, you know, the photon goes in, something else goes out, and now that momentum is shared in the electron, and the electron changes its direction. Now, the electron doesn't get hit by a photon and move the speed of light. It moves some percentage of the speed of light per absorption of momentum in a direction. So just like a school of fish, if I'm going to add some new fish to the school, the idea would be I can't, because the school has to stay a certain size. So if I put 10 new fish in, 10 old fish leave, well, the 10 new fish have a direction, and the 10 old fish have a direction, and so clearly I'm changing the direction of the school overall, because I've changed the direction that I'm adding. Adding and subtracting. Which is an important difference, and it explains why electrons don't travel very straight. It explains lots of things, but again, they just preach out of this Bible, and they just don't have any willingness to say, well, maybe we draw a few wrong conclusions here. Maybe it's made some statements that aren't quite complete. and aren't quite active. And there's just no willingness to concede anywhere in this recitation of what God says.
Bring another billiard ball and making a move. So photons do have properties that make them look and act like they're particles.
So again, yes, but if physicists shouldn't fall for this look like, seems like, they have to demonstrate is like. The is like has to be demonstrated by evidence. And the evidence is first continuity of your theory. It doesn't produce these contradictions. You don't end up having to say something like virtual, or you don't have to say something silly like wave-particle duality. You don't have to say something like destructive interference, as if somehow you can destroy the energy, which you can't do.
No, they don't have mass. And, as a particle, the photon has momentum.
There you go. So why don't you just quit playing a game like it don't have mass when you know you can't write a momentum equation, you can't write a rational one that doesn't concede the existence of the mass. The mass is its momentum, the velocity times the mass is the momentum. So why are you playing this game that you can sit there and put frequency or some other notion in there and change that fact? That's the elemental function. The elemental property is that you have a certain amount of stuff and you remove it. And that's its ability to move something else. Is its mass, its the number of quanta, and its direction. And so its speed is going to be a reflection of what percentage of it is moving in balance, in one direction rather than another direction. And that's going to be your total, is understanding that the only percentage that matters is the part hitting you, the part heading your way. And there's a certain part that's always proportional. In terms of your motion, that is the byproduct of an imbalance. You have more rowers going this way than that way, and you go that way.
So just like when one billiard ball hits another billiard ball and makes it move, a photon can hit an electron and make it move. So that means it has momentum. And interesting that a particle that has no mass actually has momentum.
It's not interesting. It's stupid. So you should, that's where you should just stop and say, yeah, sorry, we didn't really fix this part yet. You know, we're just playing with these old ideas, and this whole thing was just cobbled together. And that's a nail that's really in the wrong place, and it's going to put a hole in your foot eventually, so let's fix that. Okay, let's not spout that kind of nonsense. Let's fix it, so we don't have to say something ridiculous. And they have no interest in fixing it. They'll just keep saying this stuff, like, oh, isn't it fascinating? Isn't it interesting? Hey, isn't it just a curious, bizarre thing that what I just said doesn't make any fucking sense? Excuse me. Something crapping sense.
And finally, we can say that the energy of a photon is quantized. So each photon has a certain amount of energy, and it's a fixed.
So again, the idea is that it's the same thing, all of these little bits, this quanta, is all the same stuff, and it's moving the same speed. So clearly, it all has the same energy. It's obviously all, and it just depends on where, what direction the energy is moving. And that's all there is. So all there is it's the same cue ball. So you can use the cue ball example. Use the pool table example. So look, they're all the same mass. They're all, let's say, theoretically, when you hit one, it's always the same velocity. And then you have the same scenario. Then you have a rational scenario. And again, the only part I would say is kind of wrong-headed is not to understand that the transfer mechanism is the elemental one, isn't some sort of cue ball. There's no such thing as cue ball. There's only momentum trapped and momentum not trapped. I don't think I need to draw that. I'll choose not to at this time.
Amount of energy, and it's proportional to its frequency. So we can say.
So again, so it's only proportional to its frequency when you're measuring it by a specific mechanism, like how much electricity does it produce, or how much of the energy is transmitted to, say, through induction, or through some other process that is frequency dependent. But otherwise, you're just discounting all the other energy, because because you're not measuring it. So there's a clear, I mean, you can't deny there's a clear relationship, okay, between frequency and total momentum if everything is kept the same. That is, if you have a per second way of analyzing how much energy goes from point A to point B, and you require it to be under some narrow circumstance. So this is another part of where mathematics kind of fails, is because none of the formulas come with the stipulations, what they've assumed to be the circumstance by which they're doing the math. But I mean, clearly, you know, it's not a huge insight into reality to say that if I have a fixed amount of time that I'm going to measure, and I have these two scenarios, right? So I have blue light and red light, that there's going to be more momentum exchanged, there's more momentum potentially to use in this piece of blue light than there is in this piece of red light. I mean, it's kind of just overtly obvious that you have, whatever, 40% more energy in the blue light, in the sense that you have 40% more bits moving the speed of light in the direction that you're going to hit something with. It's obviously more cue balls, okay, but there's nothing intrinsic about the frequency that changes the elemental values. So these values are the same, and the only thing you're really changing is obvious, that if you shoot all the bullets in 1 second versus waiting 1 minute, that it's likely you'll hit the same bird. Or it's likely, well, like I'm just saying, it's likely if you have some kind of elastic thing that you're going to attempt to bend, that you're going to be able to bend it if you hit it fast before it can rebound, than if you wait an hour between bullets, then obviously you'll just keep bending it this much, it'll go back, you'll bend it this much, it'll go back, you'll bend it this much, it'll go back. So if this is how you're measuring energy, then yeah, this is required. You have to have this higher frequency. But there's nothing intrinsically more energetic about the quanta itself. You just obviously increase the amount per time. So I mean, there's a stipulation to the math that, you know, they don't make it clear that that's the stipulation. That's the only way this replacing momentum with the word frequency works, is if you understand that's the confine it has to be in. And they're not doing that. They'll take that F thing to mean momentum, and they'll put in some other equation where time isn't consistent. And that's breaking the rules.
That the energy of a photon is equal to some constant times the frequency of the photon, the frequency of...
So some constant, all he's saying is that's essentially the giving it the mass component. So the constant, they don't have the mass component to make the momentum argument. So the constant is just telling you, the constant is what one of those little bits is, and the frequency is how often they're coming. So now you have your momentum argument. Now you have something called energy. Energy is just another way of saying momentum.
The oscillation of the photon. All photons, as they move through space at the speed of light, they oscillate like a wave because they're basically...
So you just started the video by saying it's a particle, it's straight liney, you know, all this stuff, and now you just turned it back into a piece of mush, an unquantized whatever this is.
A piece of a wave and a particle. Wow, well, we'll get into that a little bit more later.
Wow.
You really won't. I mean, because there's no way to make it rational, so you evade it.
Now, H is a constant. It's called Planck's constant. It's named after Planck because he did a lot of research on subatomic particles like this. And the...
Well, we just know that this number just doesn't have to be this number, only if you understand what quantity you're measuring it. So it has to be under this restraint of saying, oh, is that the number if it's joules, or is that the number if it's a newton, or if that's the number if it's a foot-pound. I mean, it's a different number depending on what, whatever you call that, designation of the quantity. I don't know. It's irritating, getting old.
H, the Planck constant, is equal to 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34 joules per second. Wow, that's a very small number. Now, since the speed of...
Right, so each little bit is a tiny bit of energy. But obviously there's a lot of those little bits, so they can do a lot of stuff and get up to megawatts a second.
Of light is equal to the frequency times the wavelength, or the velocity of any wave is equal to the frequency times the wavelength. We can write the frequency as the fraction of the speed of light divided by the wavelength. So instead of writing h times f, h times the frequency, just write it h times c over lambda.
Which is probably better, because at least now you recognize that the speed is a constant, and you recognize that the it's the now a time rigid formula, in that there's the Planckness to time, and so you're measuring this is a quantity of time and momentum, speed. So now you have speed and time in the equation, which makes more sense.
Let's do a little calculation. Let's figure out the energy of a typical photon coming from the sun, which has a wavelength of about 500 nanometers. On average, of course, there's some that have longer wavelengths and some that have shorter wavelengths. So let's say a typical photon where the lambda is equal to 500 nanometers, and nanometers 10 to the minus 9 meters, that would be 500 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. Let's go ahead and plug it into the equation here. So this is equal to 6.626 times 10 to the minus 34. That's joules.
Yeah, so this is the part that, I'm sorry, it gets a little bit tedious because it's just writing very long constants to actually come up with an answer. Again, which doesn't tell you anything you can't already surmise once you've drawn a picture of it. I mean, once I see, oh yeah, there's six of these, there's five of these, and only three of these for the same distance. I can figure out that, this is going to be 30 times more stuff than the other thing.
Times seconds, multiply times the speed of light, 3 times 10 to the 8 meters per second, and then we divide that by the wavelength, which would be 500 times 10 to the minus 9 meters. Now, for that, of course, we need a calculator. Let's see how much energy a typical photon from the sun has. So 6.626 e to the 34 minus.
So understood. This is just saying in one moment of time where both conditions are the same. That is, you don't have more of this, you don't have any gaps in these.
Okay.
So if you have the same amount of time,
Este se bombea con estos cabrones, entiendo.